Live from WTVO Rockford and your home team, Eyewitness News at 5 starts now.
It's just been one of those things that you don't know what you can, you know, deal with personally until you've gone through it.
1 year ago today, a gunman walked into Rockford's John Carter Lanes. Rockford police say the shooter opened fire downstairs, then made his way upstairs to the bar. When it was all over, six people were hit, including two teenagers. In all, three victims died. We hear from Don Carter's bar manager about the importance of never forgetting this tragic day. It's been a week since a Belvedere father and his two sons were found murdered in their home. After spending the holidays without their loved ones, family members tell us they seek justice. Good evening, I'm Michelle Rave. Thanks for joining us. Alexis Carpello has tonight off. December 26, 2020 is a day many Rockfordians will never forget. Six people were shot inside of Don Carter Lanes. Three people died. Now a year later, the bowling alley and community is still healing. Alexis Carpello spoke with Don Carter's bar manager. He tells her it's still a painful memory.
It's just one of those things that you can't prepare for.
Don Carter Lane's bar manager, Jamie Funk, remembers the mass shooting that happened on December 26, 2020, like it was yesterday.
For it to happen to you, more or less even in your community, it's scary. There's nothing that you can prepare yourself for that kind of thing, and we've taken extra steps.
Six people were shot, three killed that night. Funk knew one of the victims well.
I started here 23 years ago and met Jerome. So he's been part of my life for years. His family, he does a lot for the kids and the bowling community.
But Funk says not every victim was left with a physical scar.
Our hearts and go out to the people that had to witness that, because they're victims too. The ones that weren't shot or hurt are injured just as bad, because they had to see that, and that's just one thing that we don't want to forget about either. The staff that was on that night, I can't say enough.
Two of those staff members were Funk's family. He says the resilience they've showed this year amazes him.
Two of the people that were up here, after they went through that, they were my son and daughter, and they went out and they plowed driveways and gave all their money to the victims. Sorry, but that says a lot, you know, for them. And people don't realize, just because they went through that, and the people that were up here that went through that, they're victims as well. They can't unsee these things, and there's a lot of mental that went into that.
A year later, Funk says it still hurts.
Yeah, it's tough, and the 1 year anniversary has not left our minds. But at the same time, we want people to understand we're open, and we got a smile on our face, and we're gonna push through it. And that's what, keep coming here, enjoy the great game of bowling. You know, we talk about it, it still hurts. But we get through it, and we're here for the families. We're here for all the people that have been through this, and you know, we still try to help them the best we can.
Reporting in Rockford for your home team, I'm Alexis Carpello.
Police arrested 38-year-old Duke Webb that night. He faces six murder charges. Webb's next court date is scheduled for February 4th. Today also marks 1 week since a father and his two young sons were murdered at their home in Belvedere. Rachel Perry has been following this case since we first learned of the triple homicide. Rachel, the family says they're seeking justice.
That's right, Michelle. As of right now, police have not charged anyone for the murders, but they have named someone a person of interest. Now, Andrew's grandma tells me they want the person responsible to pay for what they did.
I am not a person who believes in death, but I believe you need to pay for what you did.
That's the message Kathy Hint has for the person who took the lives of her grandson and two great-grandsons, all three murdered at their home in Belvedere.
Anyone who can do such a horrendous thing to children especially doesn't deserve to live.
Police say Andrew Hint and his two sons, just 5 and 7 years old, were shot and have ruled the case a triple homicide. 1 week later, and Kathy says, looking at photos and talking about memories is the only thing getting her through this.
That looks like his baby, too. They just, I don't know, there's just so many memories of him. They had infectious smiles. They smiled so much.
But the family is still waiting on an arrest. Police say 24-year-old Alizé Smith was with Andrew and the boys the same day they were killed. He's named a person of interest and is being held without bond at the Boone County Jail on an unrelated warrant. But at this time, he's not been charged with the murders. Now, Kathy tells me, whoever did this to Andrew and his boys needs to pay for what they did.
This man who took their lives will pay for what he did. It's not going to bring them back, but hopefully it'll give us peace of mind.
Police are still searching for Andrew's vehicle, which is believed to be stolen. They ask if you see it, call them and do not approach it. Information on the SUV is on our website, mystateline.com. Michelle.
Thank you, Rachel, for that report. During the holiday season, many people went to the stores to purchase Christmas gifts. Sales are up 8.5% from a year ago. That's according to MasterCard Spending Pulse. The results, which cover November 1st through Christmas Eve, were fueled by purchases of clothing and jewelry. Online sales were up 11% from a year ago and 61% from 2019. While Christmas is a time of giving for most of us, for some, it's a perfect opportunity for others to take. Several police agencies say they've noticed over the years a trend of increasing home burglaries in a time period between Christmas and New Year's Day. One officer recommends not leaving empty boxes outside of your home because it allows burglars the chance to get a glimpse of what's inside.
Especially after Christmas, the burglaries actually do tend to spike up. And in the past 16 years that I've been working here, it's a common trend that every time between Christmas to New Year's, the burglaries of residences tend to spike up a little bit more than usually throughout the year.
The officer recommends people to hold on to their empty boxes till their scheduled trash date. The rate of daily COVID-19 cases during this highly contagious Omicron surge has eclipsed those fueled by the Delta variant over the summer. But hospitalizations have yet to match. More than 69,000 Americans were hospitalized with COVID-19 on Christmas Eve. According to the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, the figure remains below peak hospitalizations during the Delta surge, but experts say hospitalization stats tend to lag with time as some illnesses worsen. More headaches for holiday travelers. Hundreds of additional flights are canceled nationwide today as airlines struggle with COVID-related staffing shortages. According to the website FlightAware, more than 630 flights have been canceled so far for today, but that number is growing. That's in addition to the 1,000 flights entering and leaving or inside the U.S. that were canceled yesterday on Christmas Day. Nearly 700 flights were scrapped on Friday.
It's exciting, so it's worth the trip seeing family. So
we thought, you know, it's going to be packed. We need to be there early. Luckily, we got a direct flight.
I think we are loving it. We like being able to travel after a long time as a family.
There are more than 24 flight cancellations so far at O'Hare today, and just 2 at Midway United Airlines. Delta and JetBlue have all said that the Omicron variant is causing staffing problems. Some European countries are trying to alleviate staffing shortages by reducing the length of required quarantine periods. Many of the COVID testing sites were closed due to the holiday weekend. U of I College of Medicine won't be doing the shield or saliva testing until January 3rd when they reopen. But you can get vaccinated next week. The Winnebago County Health Department will be doing COVID and flu vaccines on Wednesday evening. You need to make an appointment. You can register on the health department's website.
Now, your first warn weather forecast from Chief Meteorologist Candace King.
You know, temperatures in the 50s the last couple of days. It hasn't felt like the end of December. Today, a little cooler, but our numbers still warming above average. And we were able to see a little bit of sunshine out there today. A live look with our Mercy House SkyTrack camera now out over downtown Rockford. We are going to keep with the cloud cover here for much of the night tonight. But we've got an active week as we round out this last week here of not only December, but also the year.
with a couple of storm systems coming in. The first one coming in here tonight. Overnight, that'll bring us a light mix before changing over to some rain showers. Next one coming in, system number two on Tuesday. Could actually see some snow accumulation from that before, again, changing over to rain. Third system coming in Wednesday night could bring us some light snow. And then we round out the week, welcome in the new year with potentially another system, one that we may have to keep a closer eye on as we get a little bit closer to the Friday night, Saturday time frame. But let's kind of look at what we're expecting as we go through this evening. Not going to be a big impact for us heading into tomorrow morning. You see some of the snow starting to develop and mixing in with some rain showers over Iowa, even a couple of lightning strikes there as we get a little bit of thunder starting to develop. And wouldn't be surprised if maybe we hear a rumble of thunder or two. Not really seeing a lot of this reach the ground just yet. We've still got plenty of dry air overhead. So what this is doing right now is working to saturate the atmosphere. Give it a couple more hours. We might see a little bit of sleet or a couple of snowflakes here by about 8, 9 o'clock, and then that will transition over to some rain. So let's put this together on Futurecast. Our temperatures right now are in the 30s. These numbers are more than likely going to drop into the lower 30s before rising into tomorrow morning. So here we go, closer to 8 o'clock. You see some of that beginning to work in from Galena to Freeport to here in Rockford. Again, that would be our time frame that we would see a little mix if we were to see that. As the temperatures continue to warm, most of this is going to transition over to rain. And where you see some of the darker colors showing up, might even hear a clap of thunder or two with that. Closer to the state line in southern Wisconsin, you may have that mix or some slushy snow linger a little longer here this evening. And that could lead to some very, very minor accumulations on grassy surfaces up through about midnight. Low pressure will then pass through very early tomorrow. That'll kind of shut off that rain and turn it to more drizzle and fog tomorrow morning. So that may be the one thing that slows you down if you're hitting the road tomorrow, is that drizzle and fog. So keep that in mind. But we are going to clear out, temperatures back into the 40s for tomorrow afternoon. We're dry tomorrow night, very early Tuesday. We are dry. Next system comes in. This one might bring us a better chance for some snow accumulation here by very early morning Tuesday, 7, 8 o'clock. We'll start to see some light snow begin to work in. That'll more than likely last through noon, and depending on kind of when our temperatures transition over, could see that linger a little bit longer before seeing that transition back over to rain then by Tuesday afternoon. Some light snow possible late Wednesday night. We're dry again on Thursday. Then we've got another system that bears some watching here once we get into late Friday night and Saturday too. So kind of an active week ahead as our temperatures will slowly drop back here by the end of the week. Numbers right now in the upper 30s. 38 from Freeport to Rockford, 36 in Janesville. Our winds, too, they are going to pick up a bit more from the southeast. Those will be gusting at about 25 miles per hour during the overnight and then into tomorrow. Up to 45 for Monday afternoon, 40 on Tuesday. And then, Michelle, we've got some numbers that'll stay in the 30s here through the end of the week. And early next week, temperatures are back down in the 20s.
Now, the Napleton Sports Desk with David Greenberg.
Yesterday, in a 24-22 win over the Browns, Aaron Rodgers broke Brett Favre's all-time Packers touchdown passing record, but that might not be the only one of his records he could break this year. The number was 443 and counting now, but Rodgers may have his eye on the number four. That is four career MVPs, one more than Favre's three. Rodgers is currently tied after winning the third of his career in 2020, but the way he's been playing this season may have him in line to go back-to-back. But the record-breaking may not stop there. Both quarterbacks are also tied for the same number of Super Bowl wins at one, and that is ultimately the record that really counts.
After 443 went up on the scoreboard, in the video played, I was standing up and just took it off my helmet. Enjoyed that video, took a seat on the bench, saw Favre's message, and yeah, man, the emotions just kind of hit me, and the gratitude for such a long career and to be a part of history like that for this franchise is, just something that I'm really proud of and extremely grateful for.
Well, the owner of the Bears, let's check in on the Bears score here, because we can't show highlights till the game's over, but they're currently in the third up in Seattle with the Bears trailing 24-14. It's a snowy one. David Montgomery and Khalil Herbert have the Bears 2 touchdowns. Nick Foles has been leading the Bears at quarterback with Justin Fields and Andy Dalton sidelined. Some unfortunate news for James Robinson, who was carted off the field today in the Jaguars game against the Jets. Came in a non-contact injury. See him here in a sec. Down on the ground, grabbing at his leg. As you see the replay, just goes down untouched. Initial reports were that Robinson suffered an Achilles injury. Jags interim head coach Daryl Bevel provided an update in his post-game press conference and confirmed the Rockford native did indeed tear his Achilles, which means he'll be done for the year.
Yeah, you know, it's unfortunate for us that we lose a player of, you know, James's caliber. And, yeah, I mean, he's such a rock for us on you know, really on our team as well as the offense. And, you know, when one of your bell cows like that goes down, it's a tough blow.
Wishing him a speedy recovery. Staying on the subject of bad news, Bulls just can't catch a break. Now, Lonzo Ball has entered the league's COVID health and safety protocols, the latest Bulls player to have his name added to the list, with numerous players now returning to the lineup after missing time in recent weeks. Ball had been one of the only Bulls players to not miss a game this season. Lonzo was asked earlier in the week how he's avoided going on the list by the media. So when he got the news, he took to Twitter and wrote, "Y'all jinxed me." Lonzo will be out 10 days or until he has two consecutive negative tests. Bulls will be at home tonight taking on the Pacers for what seems like their first game in forever after the recent ones had been postponed as a result of COVID.
The First Warren Interactive Radar gets a little more active over the next couple of days. Watch for a light mix and then rain overnight. Thanks for making us your home team. We'll see you tonight at 10.